Hello, my name is Xander. Welcome to the ORM Mastery course, Level 1 for Beginners. This tutorial is part of the YouTube edition playlist, Django Database ORM Mastery. You can find a link to this playlist in the video description, where you'll find all the tutorials associated to this course. In this tutorial, we explore the difference between save and the create function for saving data to the database. If you would like to follow along step by step, you can download our base Django project, Codebase 1. There is a link in the video description to that code. Now, if you are not familiar with Django and how to start a new Django project, there is also a video guide on how to download and start the project. Again, there is a link in the video description to that. If you like this course and would like to learn more, then do consider our course on Udemy, Django Database ORM Mastery Level 1. The actual thumbnail might change over time, but just look for Created by Very Academy. There is a link in the video description to the course. That is always going to give you the best price for the course. So one of the key differences between the .save method and the .create method is the save method provides a little bit more than just saving objects into the database. So let me just take you through a simple example, and that will help us explain some of the key differences here. Right, so from the models, let's go ahead and we utilize the brand and category table. I will promise I will stop saying this, but if you want to follow along step by step, have a look at the setup guide at the start of this section. That will take you to this point here, and we can go ahead and move into the shell. Okay, so we're going to be working with brand and potentially category. So let's go ahead and bring that into our terminal so we can access those tables. I'll just clear that. So let's go ahead and create some data first with the create. So brand.object.create. And then we go ahead and say brand ID. Remember there's a primary key, brand ID, and then name equals, we'll go for Nike again. Right. Okay. So we'll do this. Now, before we do that, we'll probably need to just go ahead and delete everything in the brand table. So we'll do that. So we want to delete everything. So everything is now deleted. So we'll just run that command first. Now, remember, these commands are all available in the tutorial. There's a download section. You can download these in a markdown file. Right. So let's go ahead now and create a new object utilizing create. So that now adds a new object into a database. We now have a new row. So let's just try that again. So we probably already know, if you remember from the create tutorial, that if we try to insert similar data, or if we try to insert into a primary key field a value that is already inserted into the database. So remember, we've already inserted brand ID 1. It's a primary key. So this value 1 needs to be unique, so we can't add it again. And also, we've also set the name to be unique, so we can't add the same name twice in the database. So let's go ahead and do that again. You can see that we return an error. Let's have a look at the behavior. I'll just clear that. Let's have a look at the behavior if we were to utilize, for example, so brand... we use brand, we bring this in. So let's now use the save method. So x equals brand. Oh, we'll just do this as a one-liner, dot save. Okay, so let's use the save function method to save data, see what happens. And you can see here, we don't return an error. So there's a rule here. So when we utilize the save method, it will save data into the database if, for example, the object's primary key attribute is not set. So if we do not set the primary key and we're using, for example, an auto-incremented, like we saw in the previous tutorial, auto-incremented field, then what happens, we're then going to insert data into the database. Now, if, for example, like this case, we do specify the primary key, and it does exist already in the database, so this would essentially return true. It does exist. This is the primary key. Then what happens is that we perform an update and not an insert. So in this case, what we've done is we've just essentially just added, if you like, this data back into the database. We've just overridden the data with this data. So let's go back into the table just to let that make a little bit more sense. So here we show the table. So you can see that we only have one entry in our brand table. That's brand one and the name Nike. Okay, so let's go ahead now and, for example, utilize the same command again using save, remember. And this time we're going to keep the brand ID as one. Remember, that's a primary key. That's going to be matched. But this time we're going to change the name to, say, Nike 100. So let's go ahead and run that. So we then go ahead and reinspect the data in the database. And you can now see it's been overridden. It's been updated. So the key here is to remember that we have manually specified the primary key. Now, we are utilizing a table at the moment, a model which has a manual primary key. We've manually set it. So let's explore the same behavior in a table which Django's automatically created the ID for. So that was the category table. So Django's created the primary key for us here. So let's utilize the same principles here, but on this table. So let's just go ahead and remove any data that's in the category table. You can see I've already done that. So we've removed any data from the category table. Right, so let's first of all utilize the create. So we'll just copy this in and construct this quickly. So category object create, and then we're going to create a new object. Right, so we go ahead and create that. So we create this new object. There we go. So we now have new data in the database. So let's run this again. And you can see that we had the unique constraint failed. And it's failed because the slug here, in actual fact, needs to be unique. So let's just quickly explore that in our model. So you can see here that the slug has been set to unique equals true. So this field does need to be unique. So we can manually specify the primary key. Now, there's a rule here. Inside the models, notice that we don't specify the primary key. So we've learned that. Okay. So if we go into the models here, we can see that we have the ID here, and it's referred to the field name is ID. Well, here in Django, regardless of whether we've defined our primary key ourselves or not, we can access the model's primary key through the property called PK. So we can access this primary key either using PK, specifying PK, or ID in this case. So let's go ahead, and we know by looking at the table, show the table. We know this is ID3. So why is it ID3 and not ID1? I mentioned earlier that it's auto incrementing starting from the number one value. Well, the reason why that is, and I left the code earlier, you may have saw it, I've added some data already and removed it. So even though I've removed data from the database won't start from one again. So it will just start from the last number that it knows about. So I've already inserted two items already in this database and I've removed them. And now I've inserted some more data and now this is ID3 and not ID1. So that's important to remember, right? So let's go back here into an example. Right, so now we're going to specify, not the ID, we could say ID, but we are going to utilize the PK. So PK equals, we know it's 3. So let's just go ahead and maybe change, we're not going to change anything here. So we'll go ahead and run this command. Hopefully you can see the whole command here. We'll just clear that. So we'll run that. And we can see here it says unique constraint failed, inventory category ID. So it specifically has failed on the category ID. So it is telling us that it is trying to insert this primary key. So we could use PK or we could use the actual field name, which is ID. So we give that a go again and we get the same problem. So obviously we can't add that because this ID already exists here. So let's see the same behavior utilizing the save method. Move this down a bit. Okay, so I've just copy and paste that into here. So this is our query we're going to run. So ID equals 3, trainers So that is basically just a match of the data that already exists inside of our database. So let's just go ahead and save that. We'll just utilize this at the moment in a one-liner. Okay, so let's give that a go. And you can see that we don't receive an error, because what's happened here is that likelihood is that create, the save has performed an update rather than an insert. So like we did before, we can now go ahead and maybe change some of this data. So because we know this is going to perform an update, so ID3 or PK, hopefully you understand that concept. Let's go for an update on the name and maybe the slug. Okay, so we just run this. So that should perform an update. And then we go back into the our table here, show the table again, and you can see that has been updated. For us to better understand the create and save method, let's dive a little bit deeper into the SQL that's generated when we execute these. For us to better understand the create and save method, we need to delve a little bit deeper into the SQL that's generated from these methods. So just a quick recap what's happening here. Now we are using the terminal, but the commands that we're using could be in a code file in the view file in our Django project. And of course, those are being executed. And then our ORM manager, the Django ORM manager, is then converting our code, our instructions, into SQL code. And that SQL code is then utilized by the database to execute. This process of converting into SQL, this is all abstracted from us. So essentially, we are delving a little bit deeper into the Django, what's happening behind the scenes, to have a look at the SQL that's being generated for us to inspect it. Then potentially we could, like we see in the next tutorial, we can create our own SQL code and run it directly. Okay, so we're going to need a few tools here. We're going to bring in the connection and reset queries. Now, there is a section which you may have already seen in this course where we go through the different options here to output different SQL. Ways of outputting SQL, sorry. So we're going to bring in connection and reset queries because we are utilizing methods that aren't returning query set, new query sets. So we're using create, for example. So we're going to be utilizing connection and reset queries. So let's just bring that into our terminal so that we have access to them. And then we're going to go ahead and delete the brand, the objects from the brand table. There's nothing there in my case. Right, so we have an empty brand table now. So what we're going to do first is now just reset the queries so there isn't anything stored behind the scenes. And then we go ahead and we run a save. Oh, actually, we'll go for a create first. So we utilize create. So just previous commands we're using here. So we're going to create a new brand object. There we go. So now we've created that behind the scenes. Django has stored the SQL. So let's go ahead and view that. So we're going to be utilizing connection.queries now. And we can see the SQL code associated to what we just executed here, utilizing the create method. If we take a look, you can see that we're using this keyword insert, SQL insert, and then we define what table we want to insert the data into. And then we specify the fields in the table and then the data. So you can see the dynamics of an SQL statement here. Like I said, we'll look at this further in the next tutorial and build our own SQL statements, but that's an insert. Okay, so let's go ahead and have a look at the save. Let's zoom out a little bit here. So that was create. So we'd go ahead and just reset this data so it clears that SQL code. So we'll go ahead and utilize now the save method. So where are we? Brand save. Oh, this one here. Okay, so we'll change it slightly. So we don't want any duplicates at this stage. So we go for 1,000 here. So ID 1,000. Okay, so we're using save now. So we'll do that. We're safe. Now let's go ahead and have a look at the SQL and compare it with the create. So you can see here that in actual fact, the code is slightly different here. Just by looking at it briefly without understanding anything, we can see it doesn't quite match. So it looks like we are performing an update. And then we go ahead and then we try and perform an insert. So it looks like just by looking at it initially, that we try to initially create an update statement, and then we go ahead and try then to insert. Now what's happening here really is that we try to perform an update first. Now it tries to perform an update on data that might exist. So we try to perform an update where the inventory brand ID equals 1000. Now we know that doesn't exist in the table. So therefore this doesn't do anything at all. So therefore a second SQL statement is run, an insert into. So an insert is run similar to what we have here, pretty much exactly the same code. We insert the information then into the database. So we can see behind the scenes what is being generated and what is trying to be executed on the database. So remember, if I didn't make it clear, this is the type of language, the code that the database understands and is able to then follow these instructions to perform and execute. So let's just see the SQL generated when we do perform an update. So we run the same command again. Now remember, this already now exists in our database. So actually, let's not forget to reset first. So reset first. So let's go ahead now and run the same save method. Okay, so obviously that exists in the database. So potentially we performed an update now. So let's go and have a look at the query generated. Now here you can see that only one SQL statement was actually executed because it found the information. So therefore, only one statement was needed. Whereas before, when we run this first, we saw the second SQL statement of actually inserting data into the database. So this is an update SQL statement. And you can see that what we're updating here, the data and where we're inserting it. So hopefully what's come across in this tutorial is that there is a big difference between save and the create method. Remembering that the save method will update data in the database if, for example, data that is supplied to the database includes a primary key that matches an existing entry in our database. Hopefully viewing the SQL behind the scenes has helped us understand a little bit more and has kind of embellished the idea and the principles of some of the key differences between save and create.